I'm not Italian. Pure Dutch. Born in Groningen. Okay. Not the way on the way home back. Not the
way. This here's the Guardian fan club headquarters right across the street. If your eyes
could see how much you mean to me. When I left the States, I'd had a really bad drug problem. And I kind of went to Paris to kind of clear my head.
Okay, we're tired. We're done. See ya. Date is May, what, 19th, 1998. Short hair.
Is it May 19th?
Skinny bodies.
Getting there.
New diets.
Cut down the carbohydrates, and as much as I love coming to Holland and eating the mayonnaise and French fries, I am putting those out of my diet for the time being.
We're looking for Dave and Tony. They're around here somewhere in Nashville. So.
Yeah. They're lost.
We're trying to find them, and hopefully we will in an hour or two. We haven't been to Europe much lately, yeah. A couple times.
We've been to Europe 20 times in the last 8 years. That's a lot of frequent flyer miles. That's a whole lot of frequent flyer miles.
Basically, I felt like I really had to take some time off for the road. All the guys in Guardian, we have quite a few children, and my son is the oldest. He is 13 now, and I really felt like God was telling me, you know what, you really need to be home during these years. And the guys were really cool and said, man, take some time off and be with your family. And I was fortunate enough to be able to land a job here at Forefront Records doing what they call artist development. And why I got this job was because of my years in Guardian. Basically, the president of this company said, I want a guy who understands how the artist thinks and how he feels. So I do a little bit, we do a little bit of A&R, a little bit of marketing, and a lot of artist relations. So it's kind of worked out well that I was able to take the experiences I had in Guardian and get a day job. Everybody's got something they can give everything.
Not the way!
the good news about Christians opposing Christian contemporary music, so to speak, is actually the good news is the argument is very much nowadays unheard of in the U.S. I think either they gave up or, you know, they realized that there wasn't really a thing to stand on. You'll still encounter it sometimes in the South, like, you know, like places in Georgia or whatnot, where there's still a little bit of a mentality that this beat, this sound is just not of God, you know. And and we used to hear the whole thing about the beat, you know. Well, it's that beat, it's that do 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 do. That's the problem.
That's my fault.
Here's what I realized. Yeah, it's all his fault. He's the man. But I realized, you know, when it rains, my windshield wipers click do 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 do, and I'm not summoning demons with my automobile, you know. So I think it all comes down, you know, a noise is a noise. You know, notes are notes. It doesn't matter if it's played through an organ or a Marshall cabinet. You know, it's just music is music. But I think the motivation of the artist and the writer is where the lines are drawn, you know. You and I, we've been through some hard times. Think of all the times I've seen you fall. Through all the rain and all the gray skies, I haven't lost any love for you at all. But if your eyes could see how much you mean to me, you'd take my hand and my love, could set you free, yeah. And I'm never gonna say goodbye. I'm always standing right by your side, and no matter what you do, you know my love belongs to you, and I'm never gonna say goodbye. And every day life seems a little bit colder. You waited for love in the pouring rain. You can cast all your cares upon my shoulder. I gave my soul for you, and I'll never turn away from you. No, no.
I had four kids. We were living in an apartment before this, and they were really good, but, you know, it's hard for kids to be, you know, in a really small place. And I just got this house about 3 months ago, and it was really a miracle because if you look at the house, people think I'm rich or have a lot of money, but God just brought me the right builder, the right loan person, because on paper, you know, you put all my finances on paper and it's like, you know, it looks really bad, but I'm really thankful. God bless me. And then, like you said, we have the studio. This is the band owns this, even though it's in my house. We were renting a place, and it was okay. You know, it worked for us for what we're gonna do, but it works a lot better in the house, and we actually get a better sound. This room is a little, even though it's a smaller room, it's still bigger than what we had. And so, you know, the band owns the equipment. We're all partners in it. You know, I've engineered and done some stuff for the band. We have redoing Stryper's Yellow and Black Attack, just for the fun of it. Well, I was born in Michigan, state of Michigan. My dad became a Christian started working with alcoholics and drug addicts, which he was himself before he became a Christian. He was an alcoholic, drug addict, spent time in prison, and he met Jesus when he got out of jail, met Jesus in a psychiatric ward where they, you know, they tie you all up and all that, and met Jesus, walked out a day later, a changed man, and started working in the, went back to school and started working in the alcoholism and drug field, and I was the oldest of four, two other brothers and one sister, and so nice little household, and yeah, he was married, had all the kids, and just was, I mean, he grew up in a family with alcoholism, and he became one. Both of his brothers did. One of his other brothers died of alcoholism. His uncles died, and just really, you know, it's terrible. But it was awesome to see God, once he accepted Jesus, how he broke that chain, set free.
See my life in a movie show. I had a place I used to know. Played an actor's role, a soul for my true power. Take me down the road a ways, and I'm thankful for these better days. I never dreamed you'd love me like you do. My, it seems it's been a long and lonely winter. I hear your voice in the morning when I'm sad. I feel you smile and whisper to me, every little thing will be alright. Like the sun come shining through my window, breaks the darkness in the early morning light. You're never too far away. And as I walk down this lonely stretch of highway, I hear your voice calling me back home when I'm sad. I feel you smile and whisper to me, every little thing will be alright. Like the sun shining through my window, breaks the darkness in the early morning light.
But it's awesome. I mean, when God does that and then breaks the chain, you know, and like all my brothers and sisters are Christians, and they get married, and then our kids, and he said that he was, you know, had a horrible night. You know, he thought he was going to die. He felt so bad. He was so sick, and so he had a horrible night. And all night, you know, he just thought he was going to die. And he thinks in the morning when he thought that he might have, he remembers he thought he might die. And he said, "Oh God!" And he never called on God before. He always cursed God and hated God. And he just said, "Oh God!" And he said, Jesus walked into the room. He said the first thing he said was, "Oh my God, you're real," because he used to curse God. You know, I'd even seen him when I was a little kid. You know, I used to tell my dad, I just said, "Dad, if I had a testimony like yours, people would really listen." And he just said, "I'll tell you something, son. It's great when God reaches down and pulls you out of the gutter, but he goes, I think a bigger testimony, and you'll understand it when you get older and have your own kids." This is when I was younger. He just said a bigger testimony is when God comes in and changes that, and you don't have to live through all that garbage. You know, you don't have to go through that, and you pass it on to your children, and they pass it on. Yeah. And so, that living testimony, you know. Accepted Jesus when I was 7. And then when I was 18, I want to play guitar. And right at that time, a Christian music scene was developing. in Southern California at a big church called Calvary Chapel Costa Mesa. Yeah. And that's when all the early guys, Larry Norman, Resurrection Band, Daryl Mansfield, Love Song, and Mustard Seed Faith, all these early bands would come through and local bands would play. And I just, like, man, that's what I want to do. And so I found some guys and started a band and played in Christian music ever since.
I've got a million-dollar feeling. Sometimes, Lord, I ain't got a dime. I got a million-dollar feeling. Lord, sometimes I ain't got a dime. Oh, no. Hey! I got the Lord Jesus with me. Ow! You know he's with me all the time. Oh, yeah.
We're going across to the world-famous Jam in Java, which was previously known as Cafe Milano. This is where kind of a little coffee house that started about 5 years ago. And a lot of Christian music, just writers' nights, and people come up and do acoustic sets, and we kind of started it.
I was into like hard rock, metal, not metal, because metal really hadn't come about yet, but in the 70s I was into everything though, jazz, fusion, but a lot of rock like Journey and Foreigner and Boston and a little bit of Kiss, you know, here and there, and Zeppelin.
Just for the makeup.
Yeah, more for the makeup than anything, but, and songs like that, you know.
Your head is humming, and it won't go, in case you don't know. The Piper is calling you to join him. Dear lady, can you hear the wind blow? And you know, your stairway lies on the whisper.
Just did that, and then I went to college and I joined this jazz group and played drums and ended up joining a Christian band and getting saved in the Christian band. I would watch them pray, watch them pray. They were nice to me, but I liked the music and I liked to play music. So that was my thing, is I wanted to play music more than I cared about. If the people were mean, then of course I would not be with them, but since they were nice guys, they were not like, you need to be saved, you need to be, you know, accept Christ right now, you know. They would say, okay, if you don't want to pray, that's all right.
I've been seeing of an endless summer, yeah. I just woke up, oh yeah, from a crazy dream. Look at that. With my eyes wide open, yeah. And I'm seeing the things that my eyes ain't ever seen. No, no, no. Well, I heard the bell in the nick of town, but the green gets greener on the other side. Still I ride. What's a cowboy to do? From the wiggy, rise above, gonna go and I throw. I've reached the end of an endless summer again.
I grew up basically in the 70s. I grew up in California in the 70s. The whole drugs and rock and roll, that whole thing. When I grew up, everybody I knew smoked dope and did drugs and rock and roll. That was what, you know, I graduated from high school in 1979, and that was in the heyday of that whole drug time. So I definitely struggled with that. Playing rock and roll bands back then, playing the, you know, parties, clubs, wherever. And it was at that point, my parents, in their wisdom, sent me to school for a year in France. It was a good change for me in that I was out of my element. in Los Angeles, so it made me just think about other things in life. So Paris for me was like being in the desert. Even though it was a big city, it was just a change of environment that really made me think about, okay, what am I going to do with my life? What's next in life? And like I said, a friend gave me a Bible, and I started to read it, a kind of like personal meditation, but then it started to come back to me. Everything I'd heard in Christian school and my experience that once I was out on my own, I realized it was true. So when I came back, I was a brand new Christian, still a musician, and I said, God, do you still want me to play? I'll quit, I'll play. And I met an old friend of mine who used to play in a rival secular band with me, and that formed the nucleus of Guardian back in 1982.
Well, I just woke up from a crazy dream.
As I walked to church one day, I got to the door, and God stopped me, and I can't explain how it works, but he says, Carl, I'm either real or I'm not. You need to choose now. You've learned enough. You've read the Bible. You've talked to many people about who I am, about my salvation, about how I can, you know, cleanse you of your sins by salvation, by why I died on the cross, because I was like, well, why did Jesus have to die? To bridge the gap between God and man. And he said, I'm either real or I'm not. So I said, I took a step forward and I said, you're real. And when they passed out the bread, I put the bread in my hand and I had that little piece of bread, which just symbolizes his being broken for my sins. And I started to cry because it all made sense that his body was torn apart for me, just me personally. And I started to cry and I ate the bread. And then the wine came around and that his blood was shed for my sins. And only when you give up your heart, only when you let everything die, to let God in, to accept him and say, I need your help. I can't do this alone. I need your help. That all made sense at that point. And I ended up going forward that day. And you know what people said? I thought you were a Christian already. I thought you were a Christian for a long time. Man, I didn't think you were a non-Christian. I mean, I'm talking a lot of the church thought that. And you know what? It's because my outer shell looked good, but my heart wasn't right with God. He wants a relationship with us. He wants us to depend on him for everything.
It's hard to say goodbye, my friend, but this wedding can last forever. That I had one more chance to spend another day with you, and even though I know I can't, I'll see you in heaven. I'll see you in heaven. The only thing that hurts more than losing you are all of the years of living without you. And show you the life I've lived without you. Cause living without you is the only thing that hurts more than you.
And then actually my mom died when I was 11 of cancer. I've written a couple songs about it, and got, you know, God has used that songs as kind of a way to express some of those emotions. But yeah, it's hard losing a parent when you're young. Or I think any time, it's probably hard. But it was interesting too. I really have a great dad. He's a really good man. He he took us, each one of us kids, to the funeral home where they, you know, have the body on display, and he took each one of us kids by ourselves and had us look at our mother, say goodbye to her, touch her and not be afraid of her, and explain what happened, you know, what happens when we die. And and so it was, that was a real, that really impacted me. I
let so many years of life go by, thinking it's all worked out. Now I realize I do know how to say that it's over and let you go for now. Still, I wish that I had one more chance to say I love you one more time. And even though I know